Coming up next for your consideration, a most unusual Thanksgiving dinner party in Omaha.
A one-of-a-kind Christmas party in Chicago.
They're like a best friend that will help you there when you need it.
And the only invited but never identified guests to the very first Christmas.
Storytel presents a very special Thanksgiving Christmas edition of On Assignment magazine. Photographers call it the golden hour, when the sun is near the horizon, just after sunrise and a while before sunset. It's the best time to film outdoors because all the eye can see is bathed in a soft reddish gold light. We see this gold light often on the road in production, but we call it God's light, and we make good use of it, and God's grace-filled light as well, as it emanates from the people we meet in the real-life stories we tell. Our cameras regularly capture God working through ordinary people, expressing His love for us, guiding us, giving us a glimpse of heaven, inviting us to share in His work, restoring the sacred. You might say, we're stalking God. We say, we're on assignment. The weather is gloomy this week in Omaha. It was relatively benign during the start of the week. But now it's getting darker and the rain has begun in some areas. The prediction is that by tomorrow, Thanksgiving Day, the entire region will be blanketed in a larger storm, with cold rain turning to ice pellets later in the day. Many things seem to be working against us as we set out to capture this story. Lots of people are leaving town to visit relatives for the long weekend, and so traffic is heavy. Some of our extended family members are not happy that we have chosen to work on this special holiday. Bad weather, car troubles, family health, and heavy workloads make us wonder whether we should be filming on Thanksgiving at all. But we find the perspective on our personal problems begins to change almost as soon as we arrive and start investigating this surprising story of hope, human respect, and setting aside differences to do God's work.
Hold it like that, and then you peel away from you.
Walking through the kitchen and the gym in this aging parish in one of Omaha's poorest zip codes, we're all struck by its austerity, but also by the energy in the room and the slow transformation beginning for tomorrow's annual Thanksgiving feast, which is offered to the poor and homeless in the area.
So there are a lot of lonely people in the world who can't afford either the meal, don't even have a house, or just feel bereft. And so we wanted to make a welcoming community event on the day of Thanksgiving. And so from our Vincent de Paul, partnering with other churches, Protestant churches, Catholic churches, community organizations, we feed about 500 people who come now to the Thanksgiving dinner and are served with the greatest respect.
Families of volunteers arrive from all over with their kids to help out in any way they can.
Any trouble getting volunteers to help out?
No. In fact, we don't advertise that much about our meal because they just come out of the woodwork.
And they say this is just a fraction of the number of volunteers who will be here tomorrow.
It's the hardest thing, actually, is the pulling it off, because we have so many volunteers, so many people want to come back after they've done it once.
You know, we never turn anybody down. There's lots of jobs that can keep people busy. And
some are backstage assembling silverware. Others are in the kitchen preparing hundreds of pounds of mashed potatoes. Tables and chairs are brought in from a nearby storeroom, But first, the chandelier is taken out of storage for its annual trip to the ceiling of the gym. The chandelier is just one of several adornments being used to make the guests feel welcome and special tomorrow. Tables and chairs are set up, and the room is transformed from a humble gym to an elegant and inviting restaurant where all are welcome. Attention to detail is clearly important at this event.
Nice napkins, tablecloths, a carpet that we put in the gymnasium.
Flowers and decorations abound. There is a strong sense of wanting to offer the best to the poor and homeless who will be visiting tomorrow.
So the whole atmosphere is meant to be festive so that people know that they're loved and to restore their dignity.
As the last of the food is prepared for the night, and the last of the decorations are hung, the volunteers go home, ready for the following day of thanks and giving back. On Thanksgiving morning and into the afternoon, Ollie the Trolley is going around downtown offering a free ride to the Thanksgiving meal to the homeless, poor, and lonely. Ollie is a replica trolley, a staple in Omaha. And once again, the driver has asked for this assignment. The kitchen opens first on Thanksgiving morning, and the chef and his assistants finish preparing the feast. Volunteers start arriving to help out wherever they can.
It's great to bring your family and have the kids serve. They really get a heart for serving, and that will stay with them their whole life.
There she is, Miss Volunteer.
Even more volunteers are attending Mass in the church next door to prepare themselves for the day of feeding the hungry and to give thanks for the blessings in their own lives.
We look forward to so many things about this day, but we know at the same time we must acknowledge and be aware not everyone has the privilege of celebrating today with loved ones, with an abundance of food on their table, or with fond, warm memories of always having plenty.
As early as 10:30, an hour before the meal, the poor and homeless begin to arrive. Ordinarily, they wait in line outside and are served coffee and hot chocolate. Today, however, due to the weather, they are waiting indoors in the hallways and old school rooms near the gym. Just before 11, Ollie the Trolley heads out and collects the guests of a nearby shelter, a retirement home, and whomever they can find on the downtown streets of Omaha.
So we send Ollie the Trolley out, send them downtown, and
we just have that go around and actually pick up, and it says all those who are homeless. So
we'll go to a senior center, and then we go down to Sienna Francis House. And
all through the afternoon of Thanksgiving, people are invited to come and just jump on,
see who wants to come have a dinner, and bring them back.
This is my first year here at St. Peter's, so the first time that I'm going to be witness to this Thanksgiving meal that we put on from our parish and from Kuntz Memorial.
But already, in the preparations, I have seen the faith and personal gratitude to God on display.
I'm doing a great job.
As Mass lets out, the gym is filled with hundreds of additional volunteers, ready to help serve the feast and make the guests feel welcome.
Yeah, they come from all over Omaha. Just, hey, we heard about your meal and we want to come help. I said, sure.
And so we keep getting more and more volunteers every year, so we keep inventing new jobs and finding new things to do. And
some of the volunteers come so they're not alone. They're here to be in community also.
Ollie the Trolley arrives with its guests for the feast, picked up from various shelters and streets of downtown Omaha.
You bet, man. Have a great day, buddy.
All you have to do is talk with a few of these individuals, and you quickly begin to realize no one here started off homeless. They weren't always poor. They have histories. They come from families. Some are mothers, fathers, grandparents that have never seen their grandchildren. They had jobs, some careers that slid off track due to addiction, accidents, company downsizing, untold circumstances. Yet all of them are responding to an invitation to a good meal on Thanksgiving Day in a warm and welcoming environment, surrounded by old friends, new friends, children, and families.
Good morning, everyone. I'm standing here with two of the pastors from Kuntz Memorial Lutheran with me as we say the prayer this morning. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. May all who enter the doors of this beautiful room remember that you love them. Remember the generosity and love that you have for them. And may we all be touched by the service we offer in your name this day. Pray with me now. Bless us, O Lord, and these thy gifts, which we are about to receive through Christ our Lord. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
A beautiful sight for everyone. Gone away is the new bird. Here to stay is the new bird.
We hand them a plate and a tray, and then we have two serving lines. They can go on either side. Same thing on both sides.
I was properly trained. You have to have the tongs, and you have to have an opposable thumb to use them.
Turkey, ham, potatoes, sweet potatoes, gravy, dressing, cranberries, creamy salad, corn. Everything you could think of for Thanksgiving meal.
I have the cranberry sauce. I put it on the turkey. It's good. You need it.
People will carry the trays out, you know? Let them get their food, and then you carry them and take them to their table and escort them. Our goal is to make them feel wanted here and welcome.
Oh, I don't want her, you can't ever, she's too tall for me.
We have Johnny Ray Gomez entertain us, so we make it a fun atmosphere.
I don't want her, you can't ever,
she's too tall. We have people sit at the tables and visit with them, so nobody sits and eats alone. That's the whole thing. You know, a lot of these people that come here, they're shunned in the society.
We feed about 500 people who come now to the Thanksgiving dinner and are served with the greatest respect. So they're welcomed, they're given something to take home. People come and just sit with them to make them feel welcome, so somebody's just by themselves.
How did you guys hear about the Thanksgiving meal over here?
Well, you know, being on the streets and all, we're trying to get around,
does it? Well, that's good.
There's prayer, there's joy, there's music, there's polka playing.
How about that?
And then once they sit down, there's young men to take their drink orders, and they bring them whatever it is they want to drink, within reason.
Do you know the secret of it? The workers here at St. Peter's, the people passing out the food and working the tables, they're bouncing around and it just flows.
At the Thanksgiving dinner, we try very much to make the clientele and all of our guests feel, again, like human beings, and that they are truly loved. So we try not to cut any corners, so we go out to try to put down a chandelier, make a dancing area. Some of them like to come up and dance with each other. Because again, it's not just giving food. Food can be given that just nourishes the body, but our desire there is to nourish the soul as well as the body, their heart, so that they feel welcome, that they feel loved.
And we also give them a to-go lunch. We give them a turkey sandwich and a piece of pie on their way out. So.
Well, they're certainly just leftovers. But we do make soups and sandwiches and things.
With a sack lunch, yep.
But many actually are homeless, so they don't know where their next meal is going to come from.
Turkey sandwich, pumpkin pie.
So we try to give them even hope beyond the meal that they're attending.
Oh,
So as the guests leave the meal to head back to where they live, and as the volunteers clean up the gym, put the tables away, and roll up the carpet, we pack up our cameras and lights and other gear, thinking about what it all means. By the time we leave, many of us find that we've missed our own Thanksgiving meals and time with our own loved ones.
Happy Thanksgiving! Thanks!
But even though we don't get to experience our own usual Thanksgiving celebrations this year, we leave this meal strengthened with a sense of hope that comes from witnessing an entire community crossing financial and demographic borders, coming together, and finding Jesus in one another, and sharing their blessings as one big family.
We spend many long hours on the road, traveling from one story to the next, and we're amazed at the abundance of stories that come across our path all around the country. Over the years, we've filmed, produced, and archived thousands of hours of footage, covering an array of ordinary people doing wonderful, sometimes heroic things for others and for God, especially those living simple lives of extraordinary goodness in their corners of the world. Large or small, the size of the endeavor makes no difference. They are all important assignments, undertaken and accomplished because people are praying, listening in quiet, and acting on inspiration, trusting their ideas come not entirely from themselves, but from their Creator. The results are unexpected, beautiful, and often inspire others to take action in a similar way. One memorable story we produced in Chicago back in 2001 features a unique Christmas party that exemplifies this collaboration with God. It's called Where Miracles Happen, and we've selected some key scenes to share with you now. Every year at Christmas time, the renowned pro-life organization, the Women's Center of Greater Chicagoland, famous for rescuing tens of thousands of mothers and babies from the tragedy of abortion since 1984, does something that, to our knowledge, no other crisis pregnancy help center does. And that is, invite all the mothers and babies they have saved and served in the last year or so, and their family members, to gather together all in one place on one day for a one-of-a-kind Christmas party.
Volunteers preparing for a typical parish Christmas party. But the difference here in this Chicago parish is that the hundreds of families who will fill this church hall a few hours from now do not belong to this parish, nor will they have ever met each other before today. What will bring them here, one thing they will all have in common, is that at some point during the last year, the mothers who will be celebrating this afternoon found themselves in the throes of an unplanned, unwanted pregnancy, and decided the best way, the only way to solve their problem, would be to get an abortion.
I was thinking about having an abortion, and I finally made a decision that I was gonna have one. I looked through the phone book to find a number to have an abortion.
The Women's Center, another thing that these women have in common. Their search for an abortion brought them all to one of our four counseling centers located throughout the greater Chicagoland area. Thanks to counseling, education, and a discussion of alternatives, they experienced a change of heart and decided instead to give their babies life.
Right now.
will be down there when you go.
At the Women's Center, we celebrate the birth and life of Christ through the birth and life of his children. And so for many years now, we have hosted parties at Christmas time for those client families that we have helped that year.
Today will be the end product of a year's work. I'll have the privilege of seeing these little babies who were saved from abortion by the Women's Center and by those wonderful people who volunteer and contribute in some way to the Women's Center.
And then go take your picture with Santa Claus, and after that you can pick up your gifts.
Okay, thank
bye-bye.
You.
Merry Christmas.
Were you surprised when you found out about the Christmas party?
Yes, I was. I really was. I thought that they were just going to show me why not to have an abortion, and they were going to be out of the picture.
Yes. Okay, thank you. Okay, give us a quality time.
They will just help you all the way. They're like a best friend that will help you there when you need it.
One of the neat things about the Christmas party is it's the one opportunity during the year where you really get to see what you'd call the fruits of our labor.
So when these families come through there, all they know is they show up, they get a nice party, some food, and they leave with some presents, and they have no idea what's going on behind the scenes, do they?
Correct. Behind the scenes is it's very interesting in that everything is donated, and the churches in the area have parties at their church and donate the prizes, the presents, and the clothing and everything else, and they have giving trees and so on for the month or two before the party. It's amazing the quality and quantity. My guess is there's got to be many thousands of toys and or clothing articles donated to the Women's Center every year for this.
So make it as big as you can, 16, shirt.
The bags include wrapping paper, ribbon, sometimes even tape, so they can wrap the gifts, put them under the tree if they have a tree, and their children will have some gifts for Christmas.
Goodie bag for young, please.
In many cases, the mothers have no other social event to celebrate the holiday. They have no other gifts to present to their children.
This is Mary, and she's 18 days old, and I think she's going to be the youngest guest at the party this year. She's all ready for Christmas.
All these families have found joy and happiness out of what they originally considered tragedy. You see the little kids dressed up beautifully, the moms dressed up beautifully, dad's there. The acceptance of a birth, regardless of circumstances, as a joyous thing. It's fabulous.
I think that I would have had the abortion, I would be feeling guilty all my entire life. And I was like, thank you.
And so, all these years later, we again find inspiration by revisiting this beautiful story of another community of ordinary people coming together to offer thanks, support, and love on Christmas to these heroes who have chosen life and hope under such difficult circumstances.
Now, let's go back even further in time to another Christmas celebration and consider the only invited but never identified guests to the very first Christmas. The shepherds are the most ordinary figures in the nativity scene. They remind us that God breaks into the lives of ordinary people doing everyday things. Making pizza, working a night shift, sitting at a desk, and that he calls all of us to join in the work of bringing heaven to earth. Luke's gospel doesn't portray the shepherds as remarkable one way or another. They're just guys doing their job. Ordinary as they are, the Bethlehem shepherds respond to God in an outstanding way. They believe and act. In a split second, the shepherds rush off to see the sign the angel had promised, just like Mary, traveling in haste to see Elizabeth. Without a gift to give or a guiding star to lead them, they hurry to Bethlehem as they are. Although the town was small, they probably had to do some door knocking before they found the baby swaddled in the manger. The shepherds glorify and praise God. They are scared stiff when the angel appears and the glory of the Lord shines around them. But trading in their great fear for great joy, they join in the angel's work of glorifying and praising God. St. John Chrysostom says that at every Mass, angels surround the priest. The whole sanctuary is filled with the heavenly powers to honor him who is present on the altar. Although most of us don't see the angels as the shepherds did, we share the same reality. The shepherds remind us that we also may live in an awareness that God can open the heavens and speak to ordinary people.
And so we wrap up this holiday edition of On Assignment magazine with a sense of hope that comes from witnessing ordinary people achieve extraordinary results, especially when they do so in response to God's call. As we consider the homeless being fed in style by hundreds of volunteers, a yearly Christmas party in honor of families, many of them poor, bravely choosing life, or the simple shepherds of Bethlehem who went out and literally found Jesus when God asked them to, we conclude that all of us can do extraordinary things if we just listen for God's call, pay attention to where heaven meets earth, and then take action to restore the city.